बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स। आई इंजीनियर शाद मोहम्मद, लेक्चरर एट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सिविल इंजीनियरिंग, कॉमसेट यूनिवर्सिटी, इस्लामाबाद, साहिवाल कैंपस, वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस अनदर इंटरेस्टिंग लेक्चर ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट सिविल इंजीनियरिंग कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड ग्राफिक्स। टुडे वी विल बी स्टडिंग डिफेक्ट्स एंड बिल्डिंग डैमेज इन स्ट्रक्चर्स एंड दिस विल बी अवर लेक्चर नंबर 28। In our previous lecture, that is lecture number 27, we studied evaluation and testing of building materials on site and in laboratory. Okay, this is the brief outline which we will be studying today is concrete defects and damage, concrete damage due to reinforcement corrosion. Typical times of appearance of defects, recognizing defects and probable causes, defects due to construction, induced load induced defects, defects due related environmental factors and material properties, other defects alkali silicate reaction, alkali silica reaction, delayed integrite formation, fire, masonry and rending defects. Okay, concrete defects and damages can be subdivided into mechanical, chemical and physical defects. So we will be discussing concrete related defects and just overviewing some structural defects and masonry defects. Okay, mechanically concrete defects can be subdivided into impact, due to impact loading, overloading, movement or settlement. Due to vibration there can be concrete defects or damages, earthquake, explosions. In example to these mechanical defects are cracking caused by incorrect handling or fixation of precast panels. So we studied in our precast concrete lecture, that might be lecture number 25 or 24, in which we studied that how you are going to assemble the precast panels together, and you can see that a cracking can be developed in concrete panels due to incorrect handling of the panels. So chemically alkali aggregate reactions can be caused, aggressive chemical agents exposure, that is sulfates, nitrates and other salts, soft water acidic and low pH. Soft water is acidic and commonly low pH, and you can see that if you drink soft water your digestion is quite better as compared to hard water, and bacterial and other biological actions. So concrete can disintegrate due to bacterial and other biological, fungus can be formulated, and efflorescence and leaching. So these are some chemical reactions which are the cause of concrete defects. These include exemplifying is this, that chemical attack from aggressive gases and subsequent reinforcement corrosion on the top of the chimneys or the soffits of the factory roof. So there can be a reinforcement corrosion, and due to aggressive gases in the environment, carbon dioxide can react with the concrete and produce some harmful defects. Okay, physically freeze and thaw action can occur, thermal movement, due to thermal stresses there can be thermal movement, and salt crystal expansion, some crystals of the salts present in the cement can expand, and even in aggregates, shrinkage can occur, erosion can occur, abrasion and wear. So exemplifying is this, that freeze and thaw effect with progressive freeze or thaw effects with progressive scaling on the soffits of the parking structure. So freeze and thaw effect is very common in parking structures because they are exposed to environment. So these are the physical categories and chemical categories and mechanical categories in which concrete defects and damages can be categorized. Concrete damage due to reinforcement corrosion. So reinforcement corrosion can be due to carbonation and electrical currents, stray electrical currents, and due to corrosion contaminants like chlorides. So carbonation, You might have studied this carbonation and these all types of chemical reactions in concrete technology subject. Just we will be overviewing them. Carbonation, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere reacting with the calcium hydroxide present in your cement. In the concrete pour liquid, carbon dioxide plus carbon calcium hydroxide, calcium carbonate plus water. Soluble and so strongly alkaline, pH is mostly related to 12 to 13. And so above 7 pH is alkaline and almost insoluble, and much less alkalinity, that is carbon dioxide is much insoluble and less alkalinity. So steel passivated and steel unprotected. So steel becomes unprotected. Example is reinforcement corrosion following reduction in the passivity of concrete alkalinity by natural atmospheric carbonation. Reinforcement corrosion can be followed by reduction in the passivity of concrete alkalinity by natural atmospheric carbonation. So major reason is this, that carbonation is the reason, and due to passivity of the concrete alkalinity is the process due to which reinforcement of the corrosion will occur. Stray electric current. Metals of different electro potential are connected to each other in the concrete, and corrosion occurs. Corrosion can also be due to stray electrical currents from the power supply and transmission networks. So if there is some abnormality in the current flow, then there can be corrosion in the reinforcement. Example is the reinforcement corrosion evident as rust stains from the cracks after galvanized steel supports. The parapet railings were fixed in direct contact with the embedded steel reinforcement. So when parapet on parapet wall, the parapet railing of the steel was direct in contact with the embedded steel reinforcement, and there was visible rusting stains and cracks. So corrosion contaminants can be chlorides. Chemical reaction can occur. Chlorides accelerate the corrosion process. At above 0.2 to 0.4% concentration in the concrete, they can break down the passive oxide protective layer on the steel surface. There is a protective layer on the steel surface, and due to corrosive action of the chlorides, they can break. Chlorides are typically from marine salt water exposure or use of de-icing salts. So mostly in marine structures or structures constructed or buildings constructed near water or river, or those there is heavy concentration of moisture, and in moisture there are can be chlorides, so they can react with the steel reinforcement, and can be the reason of reinforcement corrosion. So the example is this, that steel corrosion accelerated by chloride ingress from de-icing salts used on the bridge and penetrating particularly through the joints over the support piers. De-icing salts are used on pavements, especially on pavements. You can see that in cold areas, de-icing salt is used to remove the salt from the roads. So they can be very corrosive for RCC placed. So these are the three reasons, that carbonation, stray electric current, and corrosion contaminant due to chlorides can be the cause of reinforcement corrosion. Recognizing defects and probable causes. Many factors may contribute or cause the deterioration of the concrete structures. These factors may be broadly summarized as follows. Errors in the design assumptions or the design process. So there can be errors in the design, or design process can be faulty. So specification or use of inappropriate materials. So specification are not appropriate, or material used is of not quality. So poor workmanship, workmanship was having quite loopholes, and defective workmanship, environmental effects, corrosive environmental effects can be the reason, overloading due to under design or change of use. So there can be change of use, means a building was designed for hoteling and this was later on converted to schooling, and there can be overloading. So unaddressed loading conditions, so accidental effects such as fires, so naturally there can be in industry, there can be fire and concrete can be susceptible to fire, and inappropriate repairs, and repairs are inappropriate. So in order to mitigate the problem, they created another problem. So appearance of the defects can be in the form of cracking, scaling, delamination, spalling, pop-outs, efflorescence, construction defects and other damages. So you can go through with this and in this document. Okay, typical times of appearance of defects. This is interesting, that when the defects can be seen and visible. So types of cracking, these are the types of cracking, and form of crack means which type of crack that will be formulating, and primary cause, what is the reason of that crack, and time of appearance. So this time of appearance is the most essential in order to categorize that which type of crack are they. So plastic settlement above and aligned with the steel reinforcement. So this form of crack is visible on the above and aligned with the steel reinforcement. So along the length of the steel reinforcement there can be cracks, and they are mostly above on the surface of the concrete. So primary cause, subsidence around the rebars, excessive water in the mix. So concrete can have excessive water, and subsidence settlement around the reinforcement bar, concrete reinforcement concrete settlement around the reinforcement bars can be the primary cause of plastic settlement. So appearance, time of appearance is 10 minutes to 3 weeks, within 10 minutes of the concreting to 3 weeks of the concreting it can occur, plastic settlement can be visible. So plastic shrinkage, diagonal or random cracks. So plastic shrinkage, diagonal or random cracks can be visible. Primary cause is excessive early evaporation. So if there is a quite hot weather condition, then there can be a high early evaporation, and on the surface there can be formulation of plastic shrinkage, cracking. 30 minutes to 6 hours. So you can see that during hardening hours and setting time, this plastic shrinkage occurs. Between almost setting to hardening phases. So thermal expansion and contraction. Thermal expansion and contraction due to temperature, it can occur transverse across the pavement. So they are transverse and across the pavement. So excessive heat generation or temperature gradients, this is the primary cause, that there is excessive heat generation or temperature gradient. Mostly it occurs on pavements, and 1 day to 2 to 3 weeks. So 1 to 3 weeks is the time duration in which this thermal expansion or contraction cracks can appear. Drying shrinkage, transverse or patterned. So any specific type of pattern can be formulated, and they can be transverse to the length. And excessive water in the mix, this is the primary reason. Poor joint placement, joints are not properly placed in concrete, is not properly placed in the joints, and joints overspaced, and joints are quite overspaced, not near, and weeks to months it can occur drying shrinkage in dry concreting. Dry when concrete has hardened enough, then this drying shrinkage can occur. So freezing and thawing parallel to concrete surface. So this is in layered form, and inadequate air entrainment can be the reason. Non-durable coarse aggregate can be the reason. After one or more winters, this freeze and thaw can be seen. Corrosion of reinforcement is another type of cracking. Above the reinforcement it occurs due to expansion of the zinc oxide formation, and inadequate concrete cover is the primary reason due to penetration of the moisture and ingress of the moisture or chloride. More than 2 years, so within 2 years or more than 2 years, corrosion reinforcement can occur based on your concrete cover and weather condition. Alkali aggregate reaction, this can be alkali and aggregates can react together. Alkali in the cements and aggregates can react together to form cracks, pattern cracks and cracks parallel to joints or edges. And reactive aggregate plus moisture, so reactive aggregates are the primary reason plus moisture content having alkalis, and typically over 5 years but may be much sooner with highly reactive aggregates. So sulfate attack pattern cracks can be visible, and external or internal sulfates promoting the formation of ettringite. So ettringite is a constituent formulated by the cement and crystalline type of formation. So 1 to 5 years means that internal sulfates can promote the formation of ettringite, and they can form pattern type of cracks. Okay, common causes of cracking in the concrete structures are types of cracks before hardening and after hardening. Cracks can be visible before hardening. Construction, due to construction movement, there can be cracks, and due to construction movement, subgrade movement, subgrade settlement, formwork movement can be the reason. Construction movement, and in plastic cracking, autonomous shrinkage, plastic settlement, and plastic shrinkage. Frost scaling and crazing can occur due to frost damage, and premature freezing can be the reason. Okay, and after hardening of the concrete, there can be volume instability, creep. Due to creep, there can be cracking, and thermal changes and dry shrinkage. So dry shrinkage, you can see that it is a category of hardening of the concrete, and this plastic shrinkage when concrete is in plastic form. And hardening, after hardening, structural design fatigue can be the reason. Excessive you can see that excessive numbers of recurrence of the loading in between elastic limit of your structure or member. Design of the subgrade can be the reason, that inappropriate design or design load or overloading condition. Physiochemical, physical and chemical action can be that freeze and thaw cycles and steel corrosion, alkali aggregate reaction, alkali silica reaction, and delayed ettringite formation. So these can be the reasons. So these are the almost all the reasons due to which cracking in the concrete can be visible. Alright, intrinsic cracks in hypothetical structure. This is a hypothetical assumed structure, and you can see that intrinsic cracks are shown schematically. Types of cracking, and these are the abbreviations against these type of cracking. Plastic settlement, you can see that ABC, this parapet wall reinforced concrete, then there can be a plastic settlement at A and B. You can see that hairline cracks. Okay, and you can see that C, there are these are plastic settlements. So these are occur near the reinforcement, and you can see that reinforcement cage has been shown, and here reinforcement. So these are plastic settlements. Plastic shrinkage, DEF. So this is plastic shrinkage on the surface. It is visible, and due to excessive heat and excessive loss of moisture, D. And you can see that E, this is surface crazing due to plastic shrinkage. And where is F? This is hairline cracks and aligned cracks to the surface. So these are the plastic shrinkage. Early thermal contraction, G and H. This one is G, early thermal contraction, and H. So they are parallel to the horizontal and vertical surfaces. So long term drying, I. So this is long term drying. So when your structure is susceptible to moisture and there is long term drying, and you can see that there can be cracking parallel to this, that you can see that parallel to support. Okay, crazing J and K. Where is J and K? J, this is surface crazing is almost on surface, and it can be horizontal and it can be vertical. So corrosion of the reinforcement L and M. So near the reinforcement L, you can see that this is a longitudinal bar of, it seems to be a column, and it is longitudinal bar of the column, and these are the ties, and you can see that these are corrosion, due to corrosion. So alkali silica reaction N. So alkali and silicates can react together, and they can form surface crazing. Alright, size, crack size can variate from hairline crack to heavy cracking, and hairline crack is less than, if your cracking size is less than 0.1 millimeter, then that will be categorized as a hairline crack, and if that is in between 0.1 to 0.3 millimeter, in between this range, then that is fine crack, and if that is 0.3 to 0.7 millimeter, then that is medium crack, and greater than 0.7, that is heavy cracking. So these are drawn to the scale cracking. Alright, defects due to construction defects. Why do construction defects occur? So these are the primary reasons that why do construction defects occur. Honeycomb and rock pack pockets can be formed and appears on the concrete surface where voids are left due to the failure of cement mortar to fill spaces around and among coarse aggregates. So coarse aggregates can be visible, and inappropriate filling of the cement and mortar in between the coarse aggregates is the proper reason of the honeycombing or rock packets pockets. This happens due to poor quality control during mixing. So mixing has not been checked properly, and there is no proper quality control, and transporting or placing of the concrete. So during transportation, there is no inadequate mixing of the concrete and factory prepared concrete. So it is saying about factory prepared concrete and placing of the concrete. So the no appropriate vibrators were used, and or over vibration was used, and under or over compaction of concrete. So under and over compaction is also the another reason that either concrete was neither compacted, or there was over compaction. You can see that low cement content or inappropriate mixed design. So the low cement content cannot be the reason. It can say that low mortar content or low mortar content or improper mixed design. So even improper mixed design can be the reason. So these are three reasons which can be the cause. Dimensional errors in the concrete structure results due to poor centering and structural members as per drawings, or errors in the details. So there can be dimensional errors or at the joints, and inappropriate centering might be the reason. So finishing errors. Finishing errors in concrete structures can involve over finishing of the concrete surface. If you are troweling and again and there are phases of surface finishing, and you are again and again following those surface finishing, then these finishing errors can occur. Or addition of more water or cement to the surface during finishing of the concrete. Concreting is finishing, and you are just placing water and cement on the surface, so there can be crazing on the surface. This results in the porous surface which make the cement permeable, resulting in less durable concrete. So this can be the reason that if your water content is too much and there is bleeding of the water, or water content is too much, then after evaporation they will leave the surface and there will be quite pervious type of surface finish, and concrete will be permeable and less durable. So poor finishing of concrete results in the spalling of the concrete from surface early in their surface service life. Poor surface of the concrete results in the spalling of concrete from early surface early in their service life. So poor finishing can result in spalling of the concrete. So these are basically three defects shown, that due to honeycombing and rock pockets and dimensional errors and finishing errors can occur. Another source of construction defects is related to insufficient concrete cover. So concrete cover can be insufficient and not as per codes, and which may be caused by shift or gauge shift. So maybe there is a shift gauge during shuttering. Improper fabrication of steel or improper placement of the formwork. So there can be defect in the formwork, and maybe there at one side there is quite large or quite thicker concrete cover, and at another side there is a very thin concrete cover. So basic categories of construction defects are site defects during site construction. There are defects and building envelope defects. So building envelopes can have defects, structural defects, and defects related to structure, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning defects. So HVAC defects and electrical and plumbing defects, leakage and variation in electrical currents, and fire or safety system defects, inappropriate resistance against fire, and inappropriate calibration of your buildings, or rating of your fire rating against of the your building. Examples of construction defects: insufficient concrete cover. You can see that vertical, this seems to be a retaining wall and basement, and you can see that the reinforcement, vertical reinforcement, is directly visible. Construction defects, proper definition is: defects in the concrete structure can be due to poor construction practices, that is poor construction quality control at site, or due to poor structural design and detailing. So these are the basic two things, that site or at consultancy. If either consultant can be wrong or either contractor can be wrong. So both should be, there should be proper check and balance, that either proper structural design and detailings are appropriate, and secondly that quality control at the site is monitored and controlled. After construction at site, the common types of defects in the concrete structures are honeycombing and rock pockets, and form failure or misalignment of the formwork. So form can be inappropriate, and dimensional errors and rock pockets or finishing errors. So there can be finishing errors. So these are the defects in the concrete surface. Okay, one by one we will be going in different types of cracking and the reason and how they occur. So plastic shrinkage. Concrete is in plastic state and there is shrinkage, and you can see that the plastic shrinkage cracking. The plastic shrinkage is caused by excessive high rates of evaporation from the surface of concrete before it has hardened. So before hardening of the concrete, due to excessive evaporation from the surface of the concrete, plastic shrinkage can occur. Drying does not take place at an even rate throughout the concrete matrix. So there is no even drying, and it happens most rapidly at upper surface through evaporation, and more slowly at the bottom through absorption. So when there is inappropriate drying, upper surface is drying and below it is absorbing, and upper it is evaporating. So there is a gradient formation in the thickness of the concrete member. So these the rate of which the subgrade absorbs water will depend on its absorbent properties. So how will the subgrade will absorb and the lower layer will absorb, that depends on the absorbent property, including its porosity, moisture content, or even its electrochemical properties. So these are the properties based on which absorption of water in the lower layer will be dependent. So causes are this condition occurs as a result of very rapid evaporation of the concrete while it is still in plastic state. So very rapid evaporation is the reason, and it can be due to within the plastic state, hot, dry, windy environment. It can be hot during hot weather, during extreme dry weather, and it can be due to extreme windy conditions. And a lack of counter measures employed. So means if there are environmental factors, then there is also humans can improvise some counter measures regarding harsh environmental factors. But if there is no counter measures, then there can be cracking. And mostly plastic shrinkage cracking can occur in these surface type of elements like planar elements like slabs and slab on grade, that type of elements, rather than beams or girders. Plastic settlement, another type of cracking, reason of cracking. Plastic settlement can be caused by subsidence around the rebars. So concrete can settle around the rebar. This is reinforcement bar and this is concrete, and you can see that concrete has settled down. And this is sometimes related to excessive water in the mix. So due to excessive water in the concrete mix can be the reason. As soon as concrete is placed, it begins to consolidate, and as bleed water rises to the surface, cement particles consolidate and concrete settles. So there can be the reason that water bleeds out, and there can be near the reinforcement there is bleeding of the water, and when water evaporates there are holes left. Okay, and the settlement process is restrained by the reinforcement steel. So concrete wants to settle, but this reinforcement has prevented this above concrete from settlement. And under certain circumstances, crack will develop directly above the steel. So due to tension at the extreme fiber and compression at this fiber, and there will be almost bending stresses, and due to bending stresses at the surface, there will be cracking. Plastic settlement cracks can be caused by what are the reasons against this plastic settlement? Inadequate concrete cover of the steel. So concrete cover is quite thin. This can be the reason. Excessive water in the concrete. Can have excessive water, too much capillary water, and form movement or blowouts. Form has been moved again and again. So this can be inappropriate and improper consolidation, poor consolidation practices, and vibrators and poor consolidation practices are inappropriate. So you can see that repeating patterns of cracks where rebars, reinforcement bars, cross members connect longitudinal bars. So you can see that in longitudinal bars, you can see that there are plastic settlements. Autogenous shrinkage. Autogenous shrinkage states that plastic shrinkage is shrinkage caused by the loss of water at to the atmosphere. Yeah, this is sure. We studied that plastic shrinkage was the cause due to loss of water in extreme weather. Autogenous shrinkage is shrinkage that takes place with no loss of water to the atmosphere. This is interesting that autogenous shrinkage, there is no loss of water. In plastic shrinkage, there was loss of water, and autogenous shrinkage, no loss of water. So where is the error? Autogenous shrinkage is caused by internal drying. Internally, it is dried, and water being absorbed by the constituent materials in the concrete. So constituent materials of the concrete has absorbed the moisture available, and there is internal drying. So absorption of water from the pores also causes shrinkage. So this can also cause surface shrinkage. And since there is no loss of water to one exposed surface, autogenous shrinkage is more uniform than plastic shrinkage. So they are more uniform. And however, tensile stresses still develop, and embedded steel can cause anomalies in areas of concrete with relatively uniform stresses. So condition can be aggressive when there is presence of embedded steel and due to high tensile stresses can be developed, and these anomalies can cause variation in stresses within the concrete that are relieved by cracking. So heterogeneous shrinkage cracking will be shallow and is non-structural issue. So these are almost shallow and non-structural issue, and there is can be some depression in the on the surface, and you can see that stresses are developed, and due to cracking stresses are relieved, and that's it. When there is there are cracks, then that means that there is no type of stress resistance. Outside corner are also high stress points. So these are corner of the building, and these are mostly high stress points subjected to, you can see that there is depression, and that is autogenous shrinkage. Crazing. Pattern cracking, pattern type of cracking also called map cracking. So this is also called map cracking, and crazing crack, craze cracking appears as a network of random cracking on the concrete surface. So network of random cracks on the surface of the concrete. The cracking is usually shallow, less than 3 mm deep, and or not structural issue. So these are surface crack and less than 3 mm deep, and they do not cause any harm to the structural weakness against loading. It is seldom a durability problem, but more of a cosmetic one. So very rarely it is a durability problem, and it is mostly a aesthetic problem, and the area enclosed by pattern cracking may be somewhere between 1.25 centimeter to 20 centimeter across. So the area in which this crazing can occur, individual crazing can occur, is 1.25 centimeter to 20 centimeter across. And crazing crack caused by premature drying. Okay, why do crazing cracks occur? Due to poor curing practices are inappropriate and not as per the standards. Environmental conditions such as low humidity, low moisture in the atmosphere, high outside temperature, high temperature, direct sunlight, and extreme winds can create high rates of evaporation from the surface layer of concrete. So these are the reasons. Aggressive environment, actually. Resistance to shrinkage from the underlying concrete cause stresses that is relieved by crazing cracks, cracking. Resistance to shrinkage from the underlying concrete causes stresses that are relieved by the craze cracking. So there is means below the surface of the concrete, concrete want to shrink, but that above surface, what they do, that there are due to shrinkage, there are tensile stresses, and on the surface there is crack formation, and they have formed crazing. So there is no shrinkage below that. Excessive water in the mix, so this is can be the major reason. Over vibration of the concrete causes coarse aggregate to settle, and segregation. So cement paste to concentrate on the surface. So cement paste comes above, and coarse aggregates goes down, and you can see that cement have a lot of susceptibility to shrinkage cracking. Overworking the surface with the steel trowel during finishing, this is the major reason that water comes to the surface, and when it evaporates, then there is surface crazing. So performing finishing operations while bleed water is still on the surface, so this is also the reason that you are performing finishing operation, you should leave the bleed water evaporate, and then you should perform surface finishing. Sprinkling cement dust on the surface to soak up the bleed water, this is also a wrong practice, that there is a bleed water, and just they throw the cement dust to let it be absorbed or dried. So that is that will form surface crazing. This you can see that surface crazing, and mostly they happen on planar structures. planar elements of the structure. Next one is drying shrinkage. Drying shrinkage is shrinkage that takes place when concrete has hardened and some degree of bonding has developed between cement paste and aggregate. So when concrete has hardened and then drying shrinkage occur, and there is proper bonding between cement and aggregate and cement paste and aggregates, and as concrete continues to dry, it will continue to shrink. So when concrete keeps on drying, it keep on shrinking. Cement have the property of shrinking. Drying shrinkage includes both shrinkage that takes place while losing moisture to the air and autogenous shrinkage. So both means it can have both phenomena, that surface evaporation, evaporation of moisture through surface, and absorption of moisture within the member, autogenous shrinkage. So the cracking will look similar to those found during plastic shrinkage. So cracking are mostly on the surface and similar to the plastic shrinkage. And dry shrinkage cracks may be the propagation of cracks that initially developed during plastic shrinkage. So it can occur that first plastic shrinkage occurred, and then later on at the same place there is a propagation of drying shrinkage, and plastic shrinkage has propagated due to drying shrinkage. Typical interruption of shrinkage cracks, you can see that there is a surface shrinkage and then there is dry shrinkage. Reentrant corners crack due to unsuitable jointing can be the reason. Settlement crack, crack due to continuous external restraint that is caused in place wall restraint along the bottom. So due to you can see that cracking due occurs due to formation of stresses, and stresses are occur due to the, this is a fixed support and there is a wall, and cracks are have been developed. So crack due to lack of isolation joints. So there was an isolation joint above, and below there is no isolation joint, and due to expansion or contraction expansion, there is cracking. Load induced defects. Structural cracks. Structural cracks include are caused by both dead and live load stresses. So both live and dead loads means service loads are included, and which can lead to eventual failure of the structure. So they can lead to failure of the structure. And previous loads were not structural cracks, they were concrete cracks, and they were not so dangerous as compared to structural cracks. So flexural cracks, structural cracks are vertical and aligned in areas of maximum tension or moment. So you can see that these are flexural cracks. Flexural cracks occur in at the center in case of a simply supported beam where the bending moment is maximum or tension is maximum. So it starts from the bottom in case of simply supported beam, or in case of it is cantilevered, starts from the top where tension is maximum, and second thing is this, that moment is maximum. So these are the flexural cracks. Shear structural cracks are diagonal and usually found in web of the member. So this is the shear structural crack, and this is the beam, and you can see that near the web of the member and support of the member, these structure cracks are visible, and they may begin at the bottom and move diagonally towards the center of the member. So they begin at the bottom and move diagonally towards the center, and at the support you can see that shear is maximum and shear develop, and you can see against this shear we provide stirrups in case of beams, and to resist flexural stresses we provide longitudinal bars, and they are very helpful in even resisting flexural cracks. So this is flexural cracks due to bending and extreme bending, maximum bending. There is flexural cracks, and they are vertical at the center in case of simply supported beam, and you can see that shear is maximum at the support, and they have diagonal cracks starting from the support and moving towards the center of the beam, and due to tension it can occur also that there can be longitudinal across the width there can be cracks, and due to torsional there can be diagonal cracks, and so these are the structural cracks and they are dangerous. Fatigue. Concrete fatigue is long-term failure due to repeated loading. So concrete can fatigue due to long-term repeated loading cycles. Fatigue is a cyclic loading, and loads may be applied in tension, compression, torsion, bending, or a combination of these actions, and even shearing can be included in this thing, and repeated tension, repeated torsion, repeated bending can cause fatigue. So in fatigue, each individual load is less than a single static or unchanging load that would exceed the strength of the concrete. So it states that a basic definition of the fatigue, that these excessive cycles are within the elastic limit of the member. So fatigue has to do with the development and propagation of growth of cracks and micro cracks, and failure of the bond between cement paste and aggregate. So there can be nano cracks and then micro cracks, and disruption of the bond between the cement and aggregates. And so fatigue is a quite longer term process and quite slower. So around the decades it forms. So cracks development and bond failure worsen slowly over time, and are influenced by a number of variables. Fatigue is not something most inspectors structural inspectors will be able to identify, and is less common in residential construction than in commercial and especially industrial structures. So fatigue is the phenomena in which that structural inspectors are also deceived, that or maybe they do not consider that, because this is very less susceptible. Defects related to environmental factors and material properties. So environmental factors and material properties. Alright, weathering. Weathering is the effect of pollution and natural forces such as frost, rain, sunlight, and they gather together to form weathering. And with concrete, the main weathering problem is unexpected variation in visual appearance of the structure. So unexpected variation in visual expression is visual appearance. So the dust in the atmosphere will be deposited on the facades. The flow of the rainwater will tend to wash some areas preferentially, resulting in significant difference in color between clean and dirty areas. So there will be some clean and dirty areas, and this phenomena is controlled by many factors, including the surface texture of the concrete, the architectural detailing, and the orientation of the structure. So so there can be a variation in texture of the concrete and architectural detailing and orientation of the structure. So they are mostly on aesthetic and mostly visible to the mostly exposed to the pollution and weather. Mold and moisture damage. Definition of the mold, mostly that fungus and algae formation on the concrete. So mold are fungi which occur naturally in the environment. Many different species of mold exist, and the mold help break down the dead organic dead materials and convert it back into organic material, which can be used by living organisms. So they mostly act like a parasite. And how molds grow? Molds grow by digesting and destroying the materials they grow on. So on which surface they grow, they start digesting the material, and they can be found almost anywhere and can grow on just about any material as long as conditions are favorable. So if conditions are favorable, they can grow anywhere. For favorable growing conditions, what are the requirements? Mold need nutrients. Nutrients include oxygen and moisture. If moisture is available and oxygen is available, then that is favorable condition for molds and material to grow on. There should be a material also. So molds reproduce by making spores. So they keep on making spores and they reproduce itself. And these spores become airborne and both outside and inside the building. So they become airborne and they spread continuously. If spores land on the super suitable material, the conditions are favorable and mold will begin to grow. If okay, that is self-explanatory. Water, food, spores and mold will grow. Appearance of the mold. Mold grow in colonies. So they have colonies and growth may take on different shapes and colors. So different shapes and colors are also available in molds. Some molds may appear circular in growth while other may grow in to cover an area. So there can be some planar area growth of the molds and some circular growth. Molds may appear brown, yellow, green or black in color. So different colors of the molds can be there, and appearance depends on the species of the mold. So there are different species of the mold, and that appearance of the color of the mold formation, it totally depends on the species type. Understanding molds. Even though molds are everywhere, they may become a problem when they begin to grow inside homes and buildings. So this is the problem, that when molds are everywhere, no problem, but when they come inside the structures, and then that is a problem. Many building materials such as drywall, ceiling tiles or wooden frame containing cellulose, which is material on which molds can grow. So these are the materials on which molds can grow. Molds can grow unnoticed above ceiling, behind walls, in attics, in basements or closets. So almost hidden areas or moisture susceptible areas, molds can grow. Molds can cause staining of walls and ceiling and can begin to break down the studs and joists of the building, causing expensive property damage. So staining of wall and studs and joints can be loosened, and so excessive moisture is the key ingredient which causes the mold growth. So this is the major reason, excessive moisture. Source of excessive moisture may be plumbing leaks near the plumb lines, plumbing pipes and leak roofs and windows, high humidity flooding and condensation inside walls due to poor insulation. So these are the major places or major reasons where molds can be formed. Common health effects of the mold are allergic reaction, sneezing, nasal congestion, irritation to the nose, throat and respiratory tract can be then, asthma attack, hypersensitivity, pneumonitis, and you can see that leaky window mold is begin to rot the wooden frame and windowsill. Windowsill and window frame is getting rot. So this was all about molds and why mold form and how they mold form and what are their basic requirements of the mold and how they can produce danger. Mold and moisture damage. Mold growing on the back side of the wallpaper. Wallpaper splashed in the back side, there is moisture and mold have been formulated. And water stain on the basement wall. Locate and fix the source of water promptly. So at the basement wall, there can be more moisture, and you can see that mold growing on the surface of a unit ventilator. There is a ventilator and there is a mold formation. Alright, next one is thermal expansion. Non-structural cracks can be caused by thermal expansion and construction of concrete, and construction of the concrete during curing processes and thermal gradient within massive section of the concrete. So a blow up of localized upward movement of the concrete curb or slab, usually at the joint or crack. So expansion can occur. So the coefficient of thermal expansion is this much, and expansion joint are incorporated in designs to take up this linear dimensional change. So for these thermal expansion, proper expansion joints are provided. If they are not provided, then there will be thermal expansion, and due to thermal expansion there will be cracking. The problem occurs when movement is underestimated. So when you have underestimated the thermal expansion, then the problem occurs not allowed, or maybe you have restrained that thermal expansion, then that is a problem. Or when correctly sized joints become contaminated with a material that is not compressible. So maybe you have provided a thermal expansion joint, but your material or that gap has been filled with some incompressible material. So cracking from the straight plane of the concrete element due to forces imposed by the thermal expansion. You can see that this is the pavement, and you can see that thermal expansion, there is thermal cracking. Alright, scaling. Definition of the scaling states that scaling is flaking or peeling of the finished hardened concrete surface as a result of exposure to cyclic freeze thaw. So flaking or peeling of the surface due to excessive freeze and thaw generally starts as localized small patches. So localized small patches, it starts, which later may merge and extend to expose larger areas. So later on they will be whole structure will be exposed, and they will spread on whole area. Scaling is classified as light scale, medium scale, heavy scale and severe scale based on the size and depth. Like this, that light scale is the loss of surface mortar up to 6 mm depth exposing coarse aggregate. So up to 6 mm, then that is light scale. If 6 to 13 mm, that is medium scale, and 13 to 25 mm, that is deep scale. And severe scale is the loss of surface mortar greater than 25 mm deep, where coarse aggregates particles are lost and reinforcing steel is exposed. So that concrete cover is lost and the reinforcing steel is exposed. So that is severe scaling. Why do concrete surfaces scale? That is interesting. A, the use of non-air entrained concrete or too little entrained air. This can be the reason. Adequate air entrained is required for protection against freezing and thawing damage. As you can see that scaling is got the repeated freeze and thaw, and for repeated freeze and thaw, if you have not provided air entraining agent, then there is no mechanism to resist freeze and thaw actions. Second one is application of excessive amount of calcium or sodium chloride de-icing salts on the concrete. So in pavements or in areas where this snow phenomenon is very frequent, so there is they apply de-icing salts on the concrete. So chemical such as ammonium sulfate or ammonium nitrate, which are components of most fertilizers, can cause scaling as well as induce severe chemical attack on the concrete surface. So different chemicals are present in de-icing salts, so they can attack the concrete. C, reason is the third reason is any finishing operation performed while bleeding water is still on the surface can cause surface scale. If bleed water is worked back into the top surface of the slab, a high water cement ratio and therefore a low strength surface layer is produced. So if water cement ratio at the top is too much and bleed water is too much and water cement ratio above the surface is too much, then surface will be weak and scaling can occur. Overworked working the surface during finishing will reduce the air content in the surface layer, making it susceptible to scaling in freezing condition. So if your structure is susceptible to freezing condition, then if you are overworking on the surface, then that will reduce the air entrainment in the surface, and that will form surface scale eventually. Insufficient curing. This omission results in weak surface skin, and which will scale if it is exposed to freezing and thawing in the presence of moisture and de-icing salts. So insufficient curing can also be the reason. So air, non-provision of air entrainment composition, and due to de-icing salts and due to bleed water and insufficient curing, scaling can occur. Pop-outs. A pop-out is a small fragment of concrete surface that broke away due to internal pressure, leave a shallow, typically conical depression. So pop-out is a conical depression has been left out, and pop-outs generally vary in size from 6 to 50 millimeter in diameter, 6 to 50 millimeter, and can up to be 300 millimeter in size. So this can be up to 300 millimeter in size. Usually fractured aggregates particle will be found at the bottom of the hole with a part of the aggregate still bonded to the point of the pop-out cone. So a fractured aggregate can be visible, and you can see an aggregate has been fractured, so pop-out can be the reason. Why do pop-out occurs? Pop-out are usually caused by expansion of porous aggregates. So porous aggregates are there and they expand, having a high rate of absorption. So if they have high rate of absorption, they can pop out, and as the aggregate absorbs moisture and or freeze under the moisture condition, it swells, swelling creates internal pressure sufficient to scale the concrete surface. So these porous aggregates absorb water, and if there is cold, then they will want to expand, and if there's no expansion, then they will burst itself, and surface will crack, and that will be popping out. Iron, stone, coal, shale, and soft fine grained limestones are commonly observed in causes of the pop-outs. You have studied these in your engineering geology, different properties of aggregates. So, delamination. Delamination is the separating of concrete layers at or near the outermost layer of reinforcing steel. So, outermost layer of the reinforcing steel, that layer of concrete can be separated. Why does delamination occur? Delamination is caused by the expansion of corroding reinforcing steel, and can cause severe cracking. So corrosion of the reinforcement can be the reason, and rust can occupy up to 10 times the volume of corroded steel which it replaces. So rust can occupy almost 10 times the volume of the corroded steel which it replaces. So you can see that delamination are separation in slabs and parallel and near the upper surface. And you can see that they are mostly occur in surface elements other than beams and other elements. Spalling. Spalling is a deep surface defect often appearing as circular or oval depression on the surface along cavities along the joints. So along the cavities and along the joints these can occur. And spalling may be 25 to millimeter or more in depth, and 150 millimeter or more in dia. Although smaller spalls also occur. Why does spall occur? Spalls are caused by pressure on expansion within the concrete, bond failure in two course construction, impact loading, and fire and weather are the reasons, and improper constructed joints or corroded reinforcing steel are two common causes of spall. Improper construction joints or corroded reinforcement can be the reason of spalling. Spalling of concrete slab due to corrosion. Okay, another type of defect is efflorescence, and efflorescence is crystalline deposit on surface of masonry, stucco, external plaster, or concrete. So on masonry, external plastering, or concrete, this can crystalline deposit is efflorescence, and it is whitish in appearance. It is whitish in appearance and sometimes referred as whiskers. So these are mostly referred as whiskers, and you can see that concrete efflorescence and brick efflorescence. Why does spalling occurs? Efflorescence. Why does efflorescence occurs? Typing mistake. Efflorescence is caused by vapor migrating through the surface, bringing soluble salts to the surface. So efflorescence is caused by the vapors. If vapors are not available, then there is no efflorescence. through the structure, bringing the soluble salts to the, these are the salts, and they are soluble salts. Fluorescence requires the movement of moisture. So if there is no movement, there is no fluorescence. Without moisture movement, there could be no fluorescence on the surface to create a problem. So if there is proper movement, then there is fluorescence. Steel corrosion. Corrosion of embedded steel in is the most common cause of concrete problem. So most common problem, as steel corrodes, the corrosion products expand, and this expansion can crack concrete and cause section to break loose in flakes. So they can cause concrete to break loose and in flake. Inadequate cover due to control joints is also common in flat work, and where control joints are installed perpendicular to embedded bars, the areas at which the control joints crosses each bar may develop cracking and corrosion, and you can see that eventually spalling and flaking. So control joint is there, and inadequate cover, so flaking and spalling can be seen. Corrosion typical of inadequate cover. This one you can see, and mostly rusting is a little dark brownish. Other defects. Alkali-silica reaction. Alkali-silica reaction can occur, and you have studied this in detail in concrete technology. Major infrastructure projects such as dams, roadways and airport runways require enormous quantities of aggregates. So they have enormous, they are heavy concreting, and enormous quantity of aggregates are required. Some aggregates can exhibit an increased or high risk of ASR. So some aggregates can be highly susceptible to alkali-silica reaction. Alkali-silica reaction is a chemical reaction. So you should be aware that it is a chemical, not physical reaction. It is a chemical reaction which occurs between the amorphous silica, powdered silica in the aggregate, and pore solution, alkalis in the cement matrix. So alkalis in the cement matrix and the aggregate silica. So alkali of the cement matrix and silica of the aggregate can react together, and the reaction results in increase in concrete volume. So there is an increase in concrete volume and causes cracking and spalling when generated forces exceed the tensile strength of concrete. So they can cause spalling of the concrete, and when tensile strength is exceeded, then they can spall. The appearance of alkali-silica reaction damage can be assessed very well on the drying concrete surface of this bridge pylon, and damage can appear within year or only after decades. So after decades it can also occur, and within year it can also occur. Alkali-silica reaction. Delayed ettringite formation, DEF, delayed ettringite formation. Delayed ettringite formation is expansion and cracking of concrete associated. So it is an expansion. Due to expansion, there is cracking of the concrete associated with the delayed formation of mineral ettringite, which is a normal product of early cement hydration. So cement hydration, it is an early product, but it can be formed later on. So delayed ettringite formation, as the name suggests, that it is delayed ettringite formation. Ettringite formation has delayed, and delayed ettringite formation results in high early temperatures, 70 to 80 degrees centigrade in concrete, which prevents the normal formation of ettringite. So if there is high early temperature in the concrete, then there will be delay in ettringite formation. DEF induced damage is not a common phenomenon in concrete. Very rarely it occurs, and less frequent. Okay, water and moisture from an external source is required for the reaction to occur, the availability of which will affect both the rate and extent of expansion. So availability of water is a must. Delayed ettringite formation, ettringite surrounds the coarse limestone aggregates, and the fine aggregate is silica sand. So ELS, impringite, surrounds the coarse limestone aggregate and limestone aggregate and fine aggregate is silica sand. Okay, other damage include fire damage, and you can see that temperature and color variation, concrete cover color and temperature, and other possible physical effects. So if that is fire is under 300 degree centigrade and your structure is subjected to 300 degree centigrade, then surface crazing can occur, and above 300 to 600 degree centigrade, concrete will color, change its color to pink or red, and deep cracking will occur, and pop-outs over cherts or quartz aggregate particles, deep cracking will occur around this 10 degree centigrade, and black through gray to buff, you can see that spalling exposing not more than 25% of the reinforcing bar surface, and this is buff, and above 950 degree centigrade, powdered a light colored dehydrated paste. You can see figure 1, that scarred and spalled underside of flat slab concrete beam. This is a beam. With the flat slab and temperature 150 to 200 degree centigrade. Surface crazing has been visible. Exposing explosive spalling pink tints. Exposure of steel ligatures and main corner bars and pre-stressing tendons. So pre-stressing tendons are also visible. Temperature above 300 degree centigrade. You can see that deep cracking and popping out of aggregate, quartz aggregate particles. And color is pink and red. So just by looking at the cracking and the coloring, you can see that how much temperature, in which temperature range this member of the structure was subjected to. And you can see that spalling of pre-stressed beam due to fast cooling by adding water described by the Swedish Tariff Association. You can see that pre-stressing tendons are there. And normal concreting is also the normal reinforcement is also there, and spalling is seen. Spalling of the concrete cover during moderate fire after San Francisco earthquake. So after earthquake there was moderate fire, and you can see that spalling of the concrete. So this is why concrete cover is very necessary, and you should properly monitor these concrete covers, that in case of extreme conditions like fire damages, your structure will be weakened very soon. Possible sources and effects of mortar distresses. Estimated time to repair of the material. If brick material is used in walls, then 100 plus years, and sealants, joints, 5 to 20 years repair is required, and metal coping and flashing 22-25 years, and anchors and tires 15 years, mortar 25 years, and plastic flashing 5 to 25 years, finishing if that is paint and used for appearance, so 3 to 5 years you should repair that, and water repellent, damp proofing 5 to 10 years, and stucco 5 to 10 years. Typical estimated time for repair. Possible sources and effects on masonry distress, and we will be just reading them out, not going in detail, because our topic was related to concrete defects rather than these structural defects or mortar defects or paint defects or something like that. So masonry, cracked units, loose units, spoiled units, hairline cracks in the mortar, deteriorated mortar joints, missing or clogged weeps, and plant growth, deteriorated torn sealants out of plump, efflorescence, stains, water penetration. Okay, you can see the mode of cracking. Okay, you can read this all type of masonry cracking in this document. So this should be your this is your home assignment, that you read it out. Everything cannot be covered in one lecture, and it is a detailed topic and a detailed expertise and field of expertise specialization, that concrete structural investigation. Okay, strong mortar and weak unit. If you have used a strong mortar and weak brick unit, so through the masonry unit, the such diagonal crack can be visible. And low vertical compressive stresses, and if there is a low vertical compressive stresses, then horizontal crack can be seen sliding along the bed joint. And weak mortar, a strong unit, and if mortar is weak and masonry unit is strong, brick masonry unit is strong, then stair step through bed and head joints. So this can be like this zigzag pattern. Brick efflorescence analysis. First, there must be water soluble salts present somewhere in the wall. Water soluble salts, this is most common efflorescence, that water soluble salts are available. Secondly, there must be sufficient moisture in the wall to render the salts in the soluble solution. So there must be moisture content, and there must be a path of the soluble salts to migrate through to the surface where moisture can be can evaporate, thus depositing the salts when crystallize and cause efflorescence. So there can be a path for getting this moisture and soluble salts to get out, and all three conditions must meet, and if one of these conditions is not present, then efflorescence cannot occur. This is important. Eroded mortar joint, you can see that erosion here is proper and here is erosion. What to look for? Slight or local erosion or mortar in joint, and small erosion depth relative to exterior face of brick, and this is exterior face and there is erosion, and this is proper. And aggregate exposed, and aggregates are exposed, and a probable cause erosion due to wind or frost cycle, disaggregating of lime components of the binder. So these are probable causes, that wind or frost action and disaggregating of lime components of the binder. Classification of defects in rendering, wall rendering, or other defects, aesthetic defects, graffiti and corrosion stains, dirt or deposits of the particles, color change, discoloration. Effects, defects associated with humidity, infiltration, dampness, stains, efflorescence, cryptofluorescence, and biological colonization, carbonation, vegetation growth. Mechanically related defects include adherence, loss, detachment, map cracking, cohesion or loss, crumbling, and scratching grooves, linear cracking. They are all available in this document. You can go through them. Okay, fluorescence rendering defects, fluorescence to wall rendering, render cracking, corrosion stains coming through painted render. You can see that corrosion is reddish brownish, and adherence, lost, detachment. You can see that and moisture problems. Cohesion, loss, crumbling, and map cracking. All right, this was all in today's lecture, and what we studied is very important and very practical. And wherever you go, you should investigate the visible causes and the size of the crack and the duration of the concreting and everything, and considering the time duration of the structure. And we studied that concrete defects and damages and concrete damage due to reinforcement collision and typical times of appearance, and recognizing defects and probable causes, defect due to construction, load induced defects, ASR, DEF, and fire masonry rending. So you can see that a lot has been covered and a lot is remaining, and this topic is quite extensive, but duration was quite less, so we could only dedicate one lecture to this one. But this is one complete specialization in itself, so we will come up with more interesting lectures in upcoming lectures. See you next week. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.